Welcome to this episode of Trill Bites. I'm Thomas Townley. If you're watching us live on sci-fi4me.2, you can chat with us live and give us your comments. So, did you watch any good Star Trek episodes on the 8th for Star Trek Day? It's the 50th anniversary of Season 2 of the original series, and there's lots of good episodes in that season. If you need a recommendation, Den of Geek has a list of what considers to be the 50 best Star Trek episodes of all time. What's your favorite? Let us know. Now, moving on to Discovery news, we're just days away from the premiere of the new show. And I'd love to tell you what I think of it as a member of the press, but CBS is refusing to release screeners for the series to critics until after the premiere. Now, come on, CBS, what are you scared of? Fox released the first few episodes of The Orville weeks ago. Now, meanwhile, at a panel at Fan Expo Canada, some production details were revealed. Supervising art director Mark Steele revealed that the current stages used for the production at Pinewood Studios are at least four times the size of the original Stage 9 at Desilu Studios utilized in the original series. Set designer Matt Morgan also revealed a lot of details about the Klingons and their sarcophagus ship. Quote, "We also sought not just to have fine-looking architecture, but also details that spoke to the history and the culture of the Klingon race, and as a touchstone, we look to the Star Trek novel The Final Reflection by John M. Ford, which was a work that was used as a launching-off pad thematically for the Klingons by Brian Fuller. So, it looks like the elements of The Final Reflection, a Star Trek novel published in 1984, might actually become canon. Have you read the novel? What do you think?" Also talked about were the Federation ships, the Shenzhou, and the Discovery. On the Shenzhou, one of the most unique things about this bridge is that it's underslung on the bottom of the hull, which presents some challenges for construction in that it was built 12 feet off the ground. It's a challenge for the crew to work in to build its massive set. Now, Morgan also discussed using the same sets for the two ships and the color scheme for each. The Shenzhou has a reddish maroon scheme versus the Discovery, which has an amber and yellow color. Also revealed was that all the screens you'll see are running live playback. Nothing is generated later. They wanted to have as much real things for the actors to work with as they could. Also revealed by co-showrunners Aaron Harberts and Gretchen J. Berg were that the 2016 election and its aftermath influenced some of chief antagonist Takuvma's motivation. He comes to power under the creed "Remain Klingon," promotes isolationism, and rails against the Federation because its multicultural approach will erase what makes Klingons Klingons. So, with all the differences from what we know of the Prime timeline, is Discovery in the Prime timeline? Discovery actor Anthony Rapp and Star Trek author David Mack both said yes. "Yes, Discovery is in the Prime timeline," wrote David Mack. "Apparent discrepancies will be addressed, resolved. It works." Rapp also tweeted, "Yes, is in the Prime timeline. Yes, 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 yes." So, I guess we'll have to wait and see. Hopefully the story is good enough that we won't have a problem with any minor tweaks to that timeline. Now, would you want to see William Shatner make an appearance in this new series? Speaking with TrekMovie.com, Mr. Shatner said, "Well, it would depend on what the participation was. I wouldn't want to do something that was a throwaway sort of gratuitous place in the plot line. That they would really have to exercise their imaginations to have a 50-year-old captain in there. If it was the character, they would have to do something remarkable. So, if he wouldn't play Captain Kirk, what could he play? Could he play a time-tossed version of Captain Kirk from the future? His father, George? Would be probably about the right age. Do you have any ideas? Please, let us know in the comments section or tweet us at sci-fi4me.com. Now, here's some breaking news. This past weekend, Jonathan Frakes revealed that a Mirror Universe episode has been made for Discovery. Now, I question if this is going back to the well one too many times for the Mirror Universe. We've had plenty of opportunities before with each series, but I guess we could see one more and see where it leads. Also, on IGN, Sinequa Martin Green raised the possibility of Spock appearing in the show. Now, we know that there are many flashbacks to her childhood. Could he be appearing in one of those? Speaking of which, we also have the title for the pilot episode of Discovery and the next three episodes. The Vulcan Hello, Battle at the Binary Stars, Context is for Kings, and The Butcher's Knife Cares Not for the Lamb's Cry. And very interesting collection of titles. Doesn't really tell you much there. And I wonder what the Vulcan Hello is. Now, here's an interesting tidbit. What We Left Behind, the crowdfunded Deep Space Nine documentary, released a sneak tweet at some of the audition tapes from 1992. Specifically, the man who had become Doctor Who, Peter Capaldi, and the man who had gone on to train Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Anthony Head, both auditioned for the role of Captain Sisko, a role that would go on to Avery Brooks. Now, they were never really considered for it. It was just due diligence on the production's part. But just imagine Peter Capaldi as Captain Sisko. That would be a very different show indeed. Now, I don't know about you, but have you gotten to see Star Trek II, the director's cut in theaters? If not, you missed a great interview with William Shatner that appeared before the movie. Some tidbits from the interview include the assistance of the studio head's wife, in getting a second Star Trek film made, Shatner's take on the plot surrounding death and aging, and why Ricardo Montalban got those large chest muscles. They're real, folks. You still have a chance to see it one more time in theaters, as an encore date has been set up for September 21st. Check your local listings to see if your theater is going to air it. Now, we usually don't cover crime much, but on the crime beat today, in 2013, an actor who had worked at the Star Trek Experience attraction in Las Vegas was murdered. Now, People Magazine reports that suspect has been arrested. Khalid Kota is believed to be involved in the murder of Charles Thomas Dicely. In 2016, Cora, along with two others, were indicted for several alleged financial crimes against Dicely, including embezzlement, forgery, and grand larceny. Recently, while cleaning out the actor's home, his son came across the bullet, and they were able to do forensic studies on it and link it back to the Colleen Quetta. These three allegedly took the former Klingon actor for nearly $1 million. Now, Cora is being held without bail on suspicion of first-degree murder with a deadly weapon and conspiracy to commit murder. We'll bring more on that as the situation develops. Now, Quentin Tarantino's Star Trek, City on the Edge Forever, is not coming to theaters anytime soon, but it's one of the episodes he'd love to remake if he could make a Star Trek film. Talking with the Nerdist podcast, Tarantino shared what he would do if he had his hands on the Star Trek movie franchise. Quote, because the whole thing with that episode was so cool, they saved the ship. But little do they know that by saving the ship, it's actually in a different time period. But they don't know that, Tarantino said. But what ends up happening is because they screwed up with the timeline, everything changes. The characters don't know it, but we know it. And the thing about it, it turns out that the Klingons and the humans on Earth have been having this 100-year war that's been going on, and it's just the bloodiest war imaginable in the history of any universe. Interesting. Very interesting. So, onto the Orville. Did you watch the Orville? If you did, you're not alone. The series premiered to a 2.8 rating in the key 18 to 49 demographic, with 8.6 million total viewers for the night. And Fox just announced today that the show earned a seven-day multi-platform audience of 12.2 million viewers, marking the network's largest drama debut in 2.5 years since Empire, with 15.6 million. The Orville posted a plus 44% lift in multi-platform viewers from live plus same day, according to Nielsen. Now, this was also the best premiere for a drama since last season's This Is Us on NBC, and also tied for the best rating of any broadcast entertainment show since the season finale of This Is Us the following season. The initial ratings for episode 2 are in as well, and even though it was delayed by some sport called football, it got a 2.6 or 7.64 million viewers, which is sure to trend upward in the next few days. Good job. And a reminder that The Orville is having re-airing tonight at 7 o'clock, the same time as the show, so thank you for tuning in to us, but if you didn't, thank you for tuning into The Orville. Now, remember to watch it at its permanent time slot of Thursday right after our favorite, Gotham. And now, a little bit of gaming news. A new featured episode has been released for Star Trek Online. Beyond the Nexus features a voice familiar to Star Trek fans, LeVar Burton. LeVar now reprises his role as Captain Geordi LaForge of the USS Challenger. He enlists your help in discovering what has happened to a ship that went out to study the strange phenomenon known as the Nexus, from which you saw in Generations. If you play, you can get rewards, including a new trilithium-laced weaponry set and the choice of an advanced universal tech upgrade or Captain Specialization Point Box. If you play each week, you can collect all three pieces of weaponry for a set bonus. Now, I personally have tried this, and it is excellent. The new interiors for the Galaxy-class starship are perfect. This is a perfect render, folks. And the acting by LeVar Burton was superb. Now, finally, have you ever wanted to have your own warp core in your car? Now you can with the Star Trek The Next Generation Warp Core USB car charger. It fits into a cup holder and plugs into your 12-volt power adapter that give you two USB power slots to power your devices while it pulses like the famous Enterprise Engineering Core. It's available now on ThinkGeek for $39.99. and looks really cool. That's it for this episode. Be sure to watch all our other shows and video gameplay on Twitch and YouTube, and check out our website at sci-fi4me.com, and we're also on all the social media. And if you're a subscriber, be sure to share us with your friends, and if you're brand new to the show, be sure to subscribe. Until next time, thanks for watching Triple Bytes. Live long and prosper.